hey, I'd love to dive a little bit deeper into each one of these. This is a pretty pretty extensive slide, and I don't want anyone to feel overwhelmed. There's about 30 questions on here that each one of you could ask. And the answers to those questions would essentially define your content marketing strategy. I'm going to touch upon a few of these today, and then hopefully we'll come back and we'll dive into each one of these a little bit separately. We're going to make these slides available for you so that you can do this yourself as well, and I'm always here to help you out. The result of that, then, is a roadmap. And so I've kind of estimated some timing here for looking at 2016 here early on, Q2, Q3, and Q4. And again, you can take each one of the answers from that framework and define what it is that you need to do in a step-by-step fashion, a roadmap, if you will, to define and get yourself and your company on the road to best practice content marketing. Okay, so again, like I said, I'm going to build through each one of these at a very high level and just touch upon a few that I think are really important. So the first thing that I often hear from companies is, you know, my boss is a little hesitant and resistant to the concept of publishing content on a brand-owned channel and investing in content marketing. What that really requires is building the business case. And the business case often comes down to something as simple as understanding that you're reaching, engaging, and converting buyers that you would have never reached if you didn't do content marketing. You're attracting an audience of folks that are doing searches on the web and that you're providing the best answer to the questions that they're asking Google. And that when you do that, if you optimize your platform, you can convert those buyers. And so you're reaching, engaging, and converting folks you would have never reached if you didn't do content marketing. And that's ultimately a summary of the ultimate business case that each brand is looking to build. I actually just recently launched a book called The Content Formula that helps answer these questions of how do we define the return on investment in content marketing and to basically give you or to give away the core components. And there's about 10 actual, we have a cheat sheet at the end. And in that, we've got a couple of levers you can pull, and every business can look at these levers that you might be able to pull and find at least two or three approaches that you can use to define the return on investment in content marketing. I'll touch on just one of them. The second bullet there under reach, look at the amount of unbranded search traffic on your website. So most of the folks that come to your website are probably typing in your brand name or your product names. But the amount of volume of traffic in unbranded search, the category, not your product, but the category that your product is in, is often vastly larger. And if you can gain a fair share of that traffic, you could increase the traffic to your website exponentially. I'll talk about how you can do that. If you look at engagement, one of the ways that we've been able to show the return on investment in content marketing, build the business case, is by looking at the engagement that you might be getting from content visitors versus advertising traffic. Or look at the value of the subscribers that you're able to drive out of your content marketing efforts. So again, a number of levers that you can look at here, and feel free to download or to buy or to listen to the book, The Content Formula. You can find that at thecontentformula.com. All right, so one of the most important distinctions between effective and ineffective content marketers is that they've documented a content marketing mission statement. I've already talked about that in one of the best practices. And so here's a recipe that any company can follow. Become a premier destination for a certain target audience interested in a specific topic to help them in some way, to help your customers to deliver value to them in some way. And so while this recipe looks very simple, the outcome of this recipe is often very difficult. What we find is that a lot of companies like to debate who their actual target audience is or like to debate exactly what topic you can be an expert in. But it really comes down to the expertise that resides inside your company and the answers that you can provide to the top questions that your customers are asking. And so you can become a premier destination. You are a thought leader. You are an expert on a specific topic for a certain target audience that can help some people to derive or deliver some customer value. The difference between content and content marketing is the destination. We'll talk a little bit about ways that you could develop a digital experience that delivers value to your customers. If you're looking for some more examples, I touch upon a few here, but if you're looking for some more examples, I just published 99 content marketing hub examples. So you can start to get hopefully some inspiration from brands that have already developed, delivered, and optimized the content marketing destination. So one of the questions we often hear is, how branded should your destination be? And so I've already talked about makeup.com, which is owned by L'Oreal, which is completely off-domain and very unbranded. You can see CMO.com by Adobe, which is very lightly branded. And then you can see American Express Open Forum, which is on-domain and pretty heavily branded, and yet all of the content that they deliver is completely non-promotional. It's totally helpful to their audience, and you can see their own mission statement there, insights, inspiration, and connections to grow your business. All right, so another question we often hear, should we build on our company URL or on a separate domain? And what we're starting to see is that we're starting to see companies that start on domain with a branded or a lightly branded content marketing hub. Mattress company Casper is a great example of this with their blog called Pillow Talk. What they found is that they had so much success with that, and they saw such a huge audience of folks that were interested in the topics that they were publishing on, that they actually went out and built a completely off-domain and extremely unbranded content marketing hub called Van Winkle. So now they have a dual approach. They have an on-domain, lightly branded content marketing hub, and then they've matured and they've moved off property, and they're now acting like a true publisher and creating this publication called VanWinkles.com, one of my favorite examples of content marketing. Another example in the B2B technology space is Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. So they have their own blog on community.hpe.com, and then similar to Casper's, they've created an off-domain and lightly branded content marketing platform called TechBeacon. And so why would a company do this? And I think the reason for this is that there's going to be a certain amount of traffic that you're able to attract on your branded domain, on your URL. And you can provide and should provide insights and inspiration and expertise on that domain. And then there are folks there's a larger group of people that you can reach once you go off domain. And there's certainly an investment that's required to do that. I know that HP Enterprise took about 25 to 35 people out of the organization and created a whole separate division. So there is investment required to do this. But I think the answer for most brands is to start on domain with a lightly branded content marketing hub.